Ajmahari here. I did want to do another comment response to the video that I did, I think yesterday. Borderlines lack empathy. This is, of course, a humongous issue, a very explosive sort of one side versus the other. I think around the fact of do people with BPD have empathy or not, what happens if they have the capacity for empathy, what are people experiencing in many relationships, the fact that not all people with BPD are the same, it's really hard to have a conversation, which is what I'm trying to start here on this channel. So if you want to share what you believe and what you feel, please just everybody be respectful to each other, because I think this is the third rail in between people, you know, non-borderlines and people with BPD. But the thing I have to say first and foremostly here is that not everybody with borderline personality disorder is the same. So this is where we have to make allowances generally. People, you don't have to in your life depending what you're experiencing. But there are going to be some people out there with BPD that might well be very empathic. And will that look like the way that an average person is very empathic? Maybe not. It won't be consistent, might not be congruent a lot of the time. And triggered emotional dysregulation will compromise, if not remove from the picture, in any relating with anyone else at times. And sometimes more prevalently than not, for many with BPD, but not all, that there it will remove empathy out of the picture for periods of time, or in some people's cases and relationships, just kind of entirely at certain points. So people with BPD definitely have capacity for empathy that narcissists really don't. Now, different kinds of woundedness with similarities, but some overlaps, but not the same. So I don't know how this video will be received at all, but I think it's important to try to talk about this massive disconnect. And it's a massive disconnect, whether people with BPD have empathy or not, capacity, what have you experienced, the person with BPD in your life, in any relationship type, versus what somebody else might experience, because people with BPD aren't all the same. And I can't underscore that enough, right? So we have to realize that I'm not talking about all people with BPD. Unless I try to say something about people with BPD that can be different from the many people with BPD that have extremely compromised empathy when triggered to emotional dysregulation, episodes around, you know, for the time around the episodes, and that can end up being more often than not in a relationship for many with BPD, but not all. Then there's some people with BPD that have different comorbidities, they have other issues going on too, that make it much more severe. The BPD, their defenses that become maladaptive in adulthood, the ways in which they just can't relate to people in the ways that other people without BPD, even with codependency, can relate to others. So in other words, you know, people with BPD tend to really see things highly in black and white. But so do some other people, and some people with codependency, and just some people in life in general. But the difference with people with BPD is it's way more extreme, and then they personalize it. And a lot of the way that people with BPD act, which impinges, compromises, or for some means they really don't have any empathy, or if they're feeling something to do with empathy inside at different times, sometimes they just can't express it or share it because it might feel too vulnerable. But remember, whatever the case is with the person with BPD in your life, or if you have one or more people in your life with BPD, like maybe a parent, maybe a friend, maybe a family member, and maybe an ex, and some people, maybe it's family members, and you know, different relationship types, it's really important to realize and to not let codependency have you believing that somebody with BPD in your life is doing something other than what they may in fact really be doing, consciously or unconsciously. It's important also not to ascribe the outcome of what people with BPD do often, which is lacking in empathy, which can be very hurtful, very cruel sometimes, verbally they can be or otherwise. Many, not all. So it's important to know this isn't to excuse poor behavior or hurting anyone else and not taking personal responsibility. But this is a disconnect. And what I mean by that, it is really a disconnect for most people with BPD who have their own understanding to a degree of themselves or how they interact, which often for a lot of people with BPD is missing a whole lot of self-awareness, because they're fighting to know who they are. They're struggling. They're defending. They're in survival mode. And especially if they have patterns of, and they're not diagnosed, but they could be, or if they are diagnosed, but they're not really seeking, you know, really significant treatment over a significant period of time. So there are lots of people with BPD today that have had a lot of treatment, and wherever they land in terms of, are they recovered fully? Are they healed well? Can they do relationships better? Well, you know, they're all over the place because they're all different. So this disconnect of people with BPD or others saying they have all this empathy, in fact, way too much empathy, and so much empathy, they feel so much for other people. Well, that might be true for some people, but it's so not true for so many with BPD. Whether they don't know how they perceive it or how they feel. But then there's the disconnect is between that narrative and or the experience of many people with BPD. But again, it won't be the experience of many others with BPD. And it might not be the experience that you, on the other side of that cluster B fence, so to speak, you might be like, empathy? My sister, my mother, father, my friend, my ex with BPD. What, empathy? Get out of here. They've been nothing but mean and cruel and horrible to me. And I tried my best to do everything, and I tried to help them, and they just don't understand it. And that can be just as real and true for so many people. In fact, it seems more people than not. And I'm using the word disconnect between these two narratives for a really important reason, to specifically go to the heart of this issue of often people with BPD and or somebody who is caring about somebody with BPD, the misperception of what is a disconnect there, that you want to believe this person has so much empathy, or they're showing you some things that you're interpreting as them being so empathic. They may interpret it that way, but could that all be a misperception? Could that all be cognitively distorted? Because that's possible for the person with BPD, for some people, not all, and for people that are relating to people with BPD, and in any relationship type specifically. So let's get to the comment now. Commenter said, it's really true that people with BPD do have empathy. In fact, they have it in spades. You see, here comes the other side of a narrative that I think I understand this, and I humbly say, because I have the experience lived on both sides of that cluster B fence, okay? But doesn't mean I'm the only one that gets it. But I think what I really understand about a statement like that is like, no, we can't say that about everybody with BPD any more than we can say that that would be impossible for everybody with BPD. So this person says, in fact, they have this empathy in spades. And really, I want to have a dialogue here. I hope you'll share your experience if you see this video. I hope you'll let me know what you think of this commenter's comments. But please be respectful, because I think we need to make more room for understanding that people with BPD are vastly different, even though there are core patterns. And that when you describe your experience as a person with BPD in your life, whichever relationship type, that's likely accurate to what you've been through and to what's happening for that person with BPD. But we need to stop lumping them all together, just like we need to stop lumping all loved ones together. But I still maintain there's a 95% of codependency in these relationships with people with BPD because of the family system dynamics, and if it's a relative or a family member, and because of the family system dynamics, if you're relating to somebody in a relationship, significant other, or anywhere else in your life, and you're not able to have the limits and boundaries that you need Which, yes, people with BPD make that very difficult. Not only because sometimes they can act in ways that just, you know, are too hurtful and to be around, but because sometimes they can just be so confusing, and then people get so hurt and they're hurting, and you know what I mean? So it's a disconnect. But let's, you know, I hope some people will comment here, whatever you believe, and if you have BPD or not. The caveat there is if you have BPD, and I don't mean to insult other people who could comment quite civilly, please, if you want to share your experience on this video too, you're quite welcome. But you need to do it without being defensive or taking things personally. This is an opportunity for you to share, how do you feel if you have BPD? Do you feel like you have empathy? And how do you display that empathy? And what's been your experience with that? As much as I want to hear from people who, if you have a person with BPD in your life and they've actually shown you empathy and you've had that experience, please share. And if not, then share what happened instead, right? But let's be respectful, hopefully. So then the commenter continues, it's just that it's a split good, evil morality behind it. Well, no, I don't think there's much accuracy to say. I mean, I hear that you believe this, so I respect that. But my opinion would be, okay, first of all, I don't know what to say about it. It's true that people with BPD do have empathy. In fact, they have it in spades. Some may, most don't, is the best I can do with that generally. And you said it's just that. So in other words, they have this empathy in spades, the commenter is saying. But the problem really is just it's the split to good, evil morality behind it. That's not even true at all. Because when people with BPD split, and you go from all good, which you don't really get back to, but all good to all bad, that is a really primitive defense mechanism. And it has nothing to do with a person with BPD's morality or lack of said. This is not a characterological issue, which I know some people are still forwarding out there. So it's not that the person with BPD splits you, devalues you to all bad because they are lacking something morally. I think that's really incorrect, and I really want to push back on that kind of like really hard, because it's just not even true. The fact that people can be, like this commenter is advocating for the fact that people with BPD have this empathy in spades, but the problem is when they split, they all good, they all bad, well, they're having a moral problem. No, I really take homage with that. It is repetition compulsions of dissociative experience triggered in the here and now from the past, unresolved, from a person who's lost their identity. It's not about morality or character. And the commenter continues, if you're going through something not of your own fault that the person considers, quote, I'll say, well, okay, that, quote, evil, unquote, then they will, quote, champion, unquote, you. And nobody does championing more thoroughly. And I'm not sure, do they mean nobody does championing more thoroughly than a person with BPD? Because if that's what you're saying, commenter, and I welcome you to comment back, I don't understand that at all. I just don't. and so I haven't found that to be true in my own lived experience decades ago or in all the work I've done with clients for 33 years. Yes, on both sides of that cluster B fence, right? So people with BPD as well. They'll champion you. And nobody does championing more thoroughly. Okay, the person with BPD will, okay, that's what they're saying, yes. The person with BPD will walk through fire and risk getting arrested if they think they are defending a person of value. Well, you might be saying this from a specific experience. I don't know. Maybe you'd like to, if you see this, you could comment and maybe clarify that a bit. But I don't think that a person with BPD, generally speaking, more than not, would be so protective of someone else because they're too busy being protective of themselves and their lost self. And with the fighting for things in a survival mode, and they do have cognitive distortions, and they do misperceive things, and they do take things too personally. And I can't see that somebody with BPD would be, to a degree, but risking walking through fire and maybe getting arrested if they think they're defending a person of value. The point is, even what you're suggesting would be like an increasing stressful situation. The more the stress would increase, the less a person with BPD would be able to maintain a consistent view of the person that they might want to fight for or support or defend that is of value. And again, BPD splitting isn't really a person with BPD in any kind of logical way or even accurate way being able to ascertain whether said person that they value so much, they will tend to split and devalue even the most valued person as the stress levels go up. So I don't know. Maybe you're talking about a specific incident where somebody with BPD really stood up for you or something in your life. And I'm not saying that's impossible. But among untreated people, it would be, with BPD, it would be impossible. So again, what you're saying here is just something that I don't hear much about. And when I had BPD, I never experienced that either. And on the plus side, they feel with you, but maybe a bit too much. See, I don't know what your experience has been, commenter, and I hope a commenter might see this and comment again. What's your experience been with this, ladies and gentlemen? I mean, I have not experienced anybody. Now, I'll just talk about people with BP that have been in my life or like that I've known or that I encountered or like recently one I've encountered. A little bit of an eye roll to that, but sorry, that's not toward everybody with BPD. But I think as a commenter says, on the plus side, they feel with you maybe a bit too much. I don't think so, because when you think they're feeling with you, they're often in a projective identification and or transference or projection where they're maybe feeling more inside because they personalize things, taking it more inside and in what they feel. And maybe that comes out like it seems like they're feeling what you're feeling with you. And are there some people with BPD that might be approaching being able to do that? Sure, they've had a lot of treatment. But generally speaking, not. So that's interesting. So that was on the plus side. Apparently, people with BPD, this commenter suggests, will feel with you. I think that's not usually common. And especially if someone is untreated. And then the commenter said on the plus side, no, that was the plus side, sorry. On the downside is when you are painted evil or the situation is actually more, quote, gray, two sides to the story with no clear top or bottom. Okay, well, with all due respect, commenter, what I'm getting the sense of with your comment, which isn't like I can say for sure, sounds very codependent. Sounds like you're allowing for perhaps a lot of things that a person with BPD may be doing that have to do with splitting. And because then you said the downside is when you're painted evil or all bad, this situation is actually more gray. No, it's not gray at all for people with BPD. It's all good, all bad, all positive, all negative. There's no gray. In fact, one of the most amazing things when people are in recovery from BPD and working hard in treatment and sticking with it and being responsible for getting this help for themselves. I know in my past a long time ago, when I came to understand the paradox of gray, wow. And I was getting close to being recovered at that point because it's like the world just goes from sort of a tinge of a kind of really black and white to like full color. And the volume goes up and you know who you are and the feelings and everything and relating to people, everything's changed when you go through. I went through 15 years of therapy to get to that place, and I got there when I was 30 years old. So it's a long time ago now, 35 years ago, actually. So the thing is, there's no gray with people with BPD that aren't really out of the active throes of BPD. They would need to have significant treatment. Because that's the issue. That is one of the most major difficult things that breaks down in relationships and communication and trying to relate to people with BPD and people with BPD trying to relate to others and even themselves is that there's no gray. They don't see gray. They don't understand paradox unless and until they get really significant treatment. So the two sides to the story with no clear top or bottom, I don't believe that either. It sounds to me like you're in a codependent space with that thought, potentially. Because top or bottom, right or wrong, I don't know what you're saying there. Two sides with no clear top or bottom. Well, there's always two sides. But that doesn't mean that when one person, often the person with BPD and especially if untreated, is misperceiving everything a person says, that there's two sides there and there's, what are you going to do with that? There are two sides, but one person's side, often a person with BPD, will be not accurate. It's accurate to how they feel and what they're perceiving, which is often being misperceived. And they might be triggered to emotional dysregulation with some dissociation, meaning past experiences coming up unconsciously and they're having all these feelings and they're not aware of it. And so then they're in that place. And the person in the here and now with them, well, they're not in the here and now with the person that's trying to be in the here and now with them. So to what you just said there, there's often a little bit more, although people can be confused on both sides, a little bit more clear of what's in the middle and how one person is maybe really overgiving and trying to fix and be heard. And the other person, often with BPD and often untreated, is just going to continue to have the misperception they're having, take something personally, be blowing something way out of proportion. I know these are not good ways to describe it, and not be aware of that and not be able to hear somebody else saying, but like, or the false accusations of people with BPD, you know, like you didn't answer the phone, so you're cheating on me. And then the person says, no, I'm not. I just, whatever the reason was, you didn't get the phone right away. But then the person with BPD doesn't adjust, doesn't know how to trust the other person, doesn't go, oh, well, I'm sorry then. Yeah, of course, I understand. No, they double down, they triple down, they quadruple down, because they're re-experiencing in all these moments and trying to relate to others as some time in the past when really things were more the way they were perceiving them. Their needs weren't being met. They were getting hurt. All kinds of negative things were happening for them. So, there's more of a clear top and bottom, and there's no middle, unless somebody with BPD is almost to the point of recovery or had a lot of therapy so that they can understand the difference between self and other, and so that they know who they are. And the comment is that I'm really trying to find ways to relate to my BPD family members. Well, just the fact that you have BPD family members, or a BPD family member, but BPD family members, plural, commenter, with all due respect, that sounds like a family system that would have to have pretty severe codependency within it. The collusion, the codependency, because you can't have people, multiple people in a family with BPD and not have family members if they don't have BPD or NPD not being codependent. And that's a family system's family of origin dysfunctional dynamic. So the commenter is trying really hard to find ways to relate to their BPD family members. A consistent way. Well, depends where they are, if they've been treated at all, or if they're in treatment or not. But if they're not, and you really can't take 100, you're going to have, okay, I'll finish the sentence. If they're not, you can't make it be consistent if they can't meet you in the middle of helping to make the communication be consistent. This is what a lot of people with BPD cannot do. And there's a multitude of reasons. I don't want to make a 3-hour video to explain it all. But I think that we need to understand that most people with BPD, now there are different rungs of BPD. It's a spectrum, right? But most people with BPD are not so motivated with the intentionality or forethought or foreknowledge and on purpose stuff that a lot of people think. And yet sometimes they will do some things that way. But the end result is, you, like in this case, you can't make your communication with your BPD family members consistent, because that's going to be you overgiving, you walking on eggshells, you doing what you're doing, but they may not be in a space, each of them may be different, might not be in spaces where they can, you know, make the communication mutual, like join in making communication mutual and reciprocal. And if that's the case, then you're likely in a codependent effort, and understand why you would want to have consistent way of communicating and relating to your family members. But again, if they can't do that in return, you're kind of left out there with, what are you going to do about that? Because, you know, you can't control that. And the commenter says, how can we do that? Well, you can't by yourself. They have to be in treatment and they have to be meeting you halfway. And then the commenter said, I just don't think it's the only answer to just say, quote, no therapy, no contact, unquote. Well, to be clear, I've never really actually said that way. Now, I don't want to be, you know, be like, going so literal as this, but literally, that's a true statement I'm making. But the thing is, for many people, if the person with BPD is not going to learn how to take personal responsibility, which requires therapy, many people, if they're not really codependent, but even people that are really codependent, need that harm reduction and need to take care of themselves and need to stop trying to fix and rescue and change the borderline, get them to hear you, you know, because maybe you really love these people, obviously, and you want to have these relationships, but you don't have any control over it and you need boundaries and you need to make sure you're taking care of yourself too. So I don't think it's as simple as, quote, no therapy, no contact, unquote, which you said, I've never said, but no contact is something that a heck of a lot of people really need and really need to choose. And I can't say that's the case for you, or, and I can't tell anybody what to do. But I think that that's why, at least I'll speak for myself, I talk a lot about the value and the need for no contact, sometimes in family relationships with family members, but more often in significant other relationships, but in any relationship type, depending what's really happening. And you said that, yeah, so you don't believe the only answer. Well, I've never suggested it's the only answer. It depends, right? Situation to situation. Each person with BPD, each person with that person with BPD, it all depends, right? I think anyway. And then you said, so yeah, not it's the only answer isn't to say, quote, no therapy, no contact, unquote. Well, I've never said that's the only answer. When these are blood relatives we may or may not live with. Well, you know what? The fact that they're blood relatives, if that really matters to you, and no matter what, that's going to make you hang in and keep trying and whatever's happening, codependency, okay? But your choice, you know? But if that's what you're doing and your family members with BPD are really not in good places or haven't had therapy, then you're going to need to work on your codependency, your limits, and your boundaries so you can take care of yourself at the same time and not abandon yourself in trying to relate to your family members. And I'm somebody who doesn't believe, I don't even know what it actually means. If somebody wants to clarify, please go ahead. I don't have time to look everything up. Blood is thicker than water. I don't even know where that comes from or what that means. It might be somewhat biblical. I don't recall. But, you know, I went no contact from my entire family of origin. Lock, stock, and barrel, every last one of them. Some of them I wasn't in touch with. But when I was around 27 years old, and I've never regretted it, and I've never looked back, and, you know, both my parents are gone now. Other relatives are gone. But the ones that remain and whatnot, and of my family, like family of origin, applies the air conditioner. I'm never looking back, because when people don't go get help and they don't change, and we go and get our help and we change and we grow and we want more for ourselves and to be healthily relating to others and vice versa, then it's really hard to stay in a place where you keep extending something to somebody who maybe can't meet you there just because they're blood. So maybe somebody will put in the comments, what does blood is thicker than water actually mean? I just haven't had time to look it up. I've heard it all my life. But it's a rather toxic statement in a toxic, dysfunctional family system where codependency will be extremely in all the spaces in trying to relate with each other, because people with BPD also have codependency. So, you know, people that are in a family of origin in a family system where there's three people with BPD within that family, or even extended family, as there were more than three people with custody in my extended family, there's going to be a lot of codependency and a lot of collusion and a lot of collusion can be unconscious, and a lot of eggshell walking And, you know, anything I say on this channel, although some people at BPD just can't hear this, and I understand that, I'm not trying to pound on people at BPD. I'm not trying to say they're horrible people. I'm trying to say they are broken, wounded people who need therapy and they could heal and recover. But if they're not going to do that for themselves, if they're mired in all kinds of other issues that make that harder for them to even choose, like substance abuse or you know, drinking to the point of being alcoholic, etc., and or other things that will get in the way of them getting help, then sometimes there's just nothing we can do. And when there's nothing we can do and they won't help themselves, no contact is the answer. And even with family members. I'm not saying you have to choose that, because, you know, you make your own choices. But I think a lot more people need to understand why no contact is a healthy choice, or low contact sometimes with family members, but making sure that you're really in a healthier place yourself and not trying too hard to help, fix, rescue, change, and be enabling somebody that you can't control, fix, change, rescue. You can enable them, but that doesn't help you and it doesn't help them either. People that are enabling somebody with BPD are really helping that person with BPD to a degree stay the same. And then the commenter says, I'd like to know, what do you need from your siblings? I remember when I read this earlier, I'm like, I'd like to know, what do you need from your siblings? Now, is that a general question? Is that a question aimed at me? I don't know. I think it's more general, but I mean, I have a sibling that I haven't had any contact with since 1988, and an arc, what can I say? And it was painful at the time, because our siblings are our contemporaries, unlike parents. And the hope is that we can go through life together, and that we can share things and grow. And that happens for many people, and for many people like myself, it doesn't. And there was nothing I could do. I couldn't change the dynamic. I couldn't get hurt. I couldn't be seen. And also, I will say that my late covert narcissist mother definitely triangulated us against each other to the point where a narrative grew over there. He had his issues anyways. Probably still does to this day. Never did change last I ever heard. And last time there was contact. So it was just flying monkey BS. And so I decided, I'm not going to stay stuck in this stuff. I wanted to find out who I was. I wanted to know who I was. I wanted to live a life of meaning and purpose. I didn't want to hang around and battle with people who didn't want to hear me, because that's something I learned a long time ago. If you're trying to talk to somebody with BPD, family member, any relationship type, you're trying to reach them, you're trying to mean all this, and when they're not listening and they can't hear you, it's time to stop talking and ask yourself, why do you need to do that? But anyways, to this question at the end that really seems kind of out of place, or it's very interesting, no criticism intended of the commenter, I'd like to know, says the commenter, what do you need from your siblings? Well, at the risk of somebody from my family of origin seeing this, after all these years, no, it doesn't hurt me anymore, and I've had to let it go, right? I've worked it through and let it go. But I guess in terms of what does one need from their siblings, I would have really enjoyed friendship. I would have really enjoyed knowing my siblings' children when they were young. I saw one of them when they were 4 months old, that was that, and the other one, never, etc. But the well was already poisoned against me by the family system that was all revolving around the narcissist flying my mother. Everybody was a flying monkey. So what do people need from their siblings? I think they want to be heard and understood. They want to be loved and cared about, as you want to care and love about a sibling. And I tried so hard to care and love my sibling, even though we had rough patches in childhood, for sure. For which I took responsibility for my part, best I could do. So what does one need from a sibling? Really interesting question, because when your sibling is a cluster B, be it like mine is a NPD, if yours is, or your siblings or your family members are siblings and they have BPD, I think everybody has to, that's a great question. Why? Because what do you need from a sibling? Everybody might answer that differently. I can only tell you what I would have wanted, because in fact, we don't really need necessarily anything from a sibling, depending, right? Like, what I wanted from my sibling many moons ago was friendship, you know, that we could care about each other. I always cared about him, much to my own detriment. And really, that was not a two-way street. But I think that, yeah, people want the consistency and the congruency of you grow up together, the hope, but you know, people with cluster B, BPD or NPD are not going to have the experience of growing up the same way as others and not have the same lens. And so anyway, I think what people need from siblings is, first of all, highly individual. But it's interesting that you framed your question. I'd like to know, what do you need from your siblings? And if anybody else wants to weigh in and answer that, please do. Excuse me, in the comment section. Because what you said, commenter, was, what do you need? And that's a codependent frame. I'm not saying just because of the sentence, but I experience your comment as being in a codependent frame. And because the question could be asked, what would you like from a sibling? Right? Because do you still really need from your siblings when you're an adult, or do you want things from a sibling? Like I said, I would have wanted connection. We never had that. I would have wanted friendship, care, mutual, reciprocal, relating. But that wasn't available from my sibling. And there were many other reasons. And at the end of the day, when I went no contact from family of origin, I did try to have a couple conversations with the sibling, but he was already so, he made his own choices, but he was already up in our mother's narrative of the twisting and the narcissistic, what's the word I'm looking for? The lies, the triangulation, the gaslighting, because nobody, well, I shouldn't say this, but nobody could do victimhood like my covert narcissist mother. And she had everybody wrapped around her little finger, so to speak. And that included me until I was about 12 or 13 and things started to change, because I wanted to individuate and I wanted to be who I wanted to be. And that's what everybody deserves to be. So if people with BPD or NPD or cluster B is rampant in your family, you may have to look at, what do you really need? And what do you need to do for you? And so I think the question of what do you need from a sibling or from siblings is interestingly codependent in this framework, because you didn't say need and or want. Because a lot of people with BPD don't know the difference between what they need and what they want. But a lot of people with codependency don't know the difference between what they need and what they want. Because I could tell you right now, did I have any needs of my sibling? Maybe not really, maybe at the time, maybe all those years ago, decades ago. But when we fully adult, and I'm going to have more coming on that probably at ajmahari.ca, and links from there that I will be putting up some brief things about where you can go to get other content. But I don't think we need anything. I mean, it's great to be loved and to have the relationship and the caring and the mutuality and maybe somebody to have your back when you need it and you have their back when they need it. But as adults, when we fully adult and the sibling makes the relationship toxic and one way, then I don't know, but I could tell you honestly, I never really needed anything from my sibling. And might have had a lot to do with what went on in our childhoods and in that family, narcissistic family of origin. But the point is, so people should think about, do you need something from your siblings? And is that something that you could be taking more care of for yourself if the sibling can't give you what you think you need? And then what do you need from siblings versus what do you want? And you know what? Sometimes in life, we just really don't get what we want. And then we have to make peace with that. We have to grieve that. We have to process that. I think there are too many people in this world in general, and not only around if you have a cluster B in your life or somebody with BPD or NPD, and what do you do? I think it's general that we've learned over the generations, and it's been going on since, well, that's more commonly known, you know, like I'm a late stage baby boomer. Please don't hold that against me. I had nothing to do with the ones that are 10, 20 years older than me in the 60s revolution. I was a kid. But the thing is that from the baby boom generation down, so it comes from the silent generation that were the children at the time of the Depression and the Second World War and all that trauma they went through. And then so many other societal, sociological, and yes, sociological aspects and psychology of humanity in a sort of macrocosm way. And the revolution of the 60s, leading to the development of the family and all kinds of complicated issues in there. And I've actually said all this in the answer to the question, what do you need from siblings? Well, I must say that question kind of caught me at the end off guard a tad, because I haven't thought about that in I don't know how long, except for when I'm talking to clients or doing a video like this. So I think the question that might be the most adult question to ask is what do people want from siblings? And obviously love, care, relationship, mutual, you know, healthy relationships. And when they're too one-sided and you're getting too hurt, and I don't know if that's your case or not, commenter, but if anybody relates, sometimes we have to let them go too, or they let us go and we have to live with that. Because, you know, I don't know that I really was in a going no contact from the sibling that I had, or guess still have, or whatever out there, but blood isn't thicker than water. Because I've developed in my life, I was going to say a family of origin. No, that's not true. A family, not only with my partner, but, you know, friends I've had for years that is like family, that really is family, that really does matter, where we see and hear each other, we respect each other, we love and care about each other, and it's mutual and reciprocal. And I never had that with anybody that was, quote, blood related to me, end quote. And that's what happens for a lot of people. So anyway, this disconnect between like what this commenter is saying, which I'm sorry, but I do, my understanding in reading your comment is it seems couched in a real framework of codependency. And that's not to insult you at all, because codependency is its own trauma response. And it's rampant in family systems, dysfunctional, narcissistic, cluster B family, families of origin, the family systems, and how they really do not function in any healthy way. So what do you think about this disconnect? That so many people with BPD will say, what this commenter said, they'll just go that extra mile for you. They are so feeling with you. They will go and they will even risk getting arrested if they think you're a person of value. Yeah, how does that conclusion get reached? Because people, even if they value you with BPD, what does that mean? And it's rather childlike and it is inconsistent and they can't hold it. So what do you think about this big disconnect of what you might have experienced with a person with BPD in your life in any relationship type, what this person is saying about three people and their family with BPD and what's going on, and how they're putting forth this narrative that usually people with BPD put forth? I'm not saying the commenter is BPD. I have no idea. They didn't say that. So, but this narrative that a lot of people with BPD will just get so passionate, upset, end up triggered and being pretty annoyed about, that they are so empathic. What do you think? And I think the best way for us to have a dialogue is if people will leave a comment, what's been your experience? And just try to do it respectfully. And if we have people commenting from both sides, I would love to hear from people with BPD. If you really think you have this super empathy, you are really empathic, how do you show people that? How are your relationships going? And have you had treatment or not? And so let's talk about it, because it is the great disconnect of one of the major core misunderstandings of all of this from both sides. And I just happen to be sitting in the middle, and no, I don't think I know it all, but I deal with this every day. You know, I used to deal with it in my life. I don't do that anymore since 35 plus years ago, but I deal with it with clients, because I don't just work with people with codependency or who don't feel so codependent. That's still something people need to understand more about. But I work with people with NPD. I work with people with BPD. I work with people who've been hurt by people with BPD or NPD. I work with people who are, you know, struggling with how to, what to do with a borderline or narcissist in a significant other relationship, family members. Like I was the child and then adult child of two cluster B parents who were alcoholic. My mother, maybe some BPD traits, but covert narcissist. And my father was a malignant narcissist, psychopath. And I had a therapist really, you know, that knew of my family system and all that I was bringing to therapy for over 4 years, said to me, they really believe my father was also dark tetrad, a dark triad. So he was a really abusive, out there, messed up, broken dude. And I mean, I had it was a lot of work to heal from that. But that's the thing. We need to be real with ourselves, whether on one side of the fence or the other, and where the disconnect is. But often, you know, people with BPD gotta get their own therapy and have their own journey. And people who love them sometimes need to have their own journey. And is that sometimes in families, could that ever come back together? Who knows? Maybe. In relationships, should it? Not really. Because a breakup should be a breakup, should be a moving on, should be a processing the grief, should be a looking at yourself in the terms of these relationships. And for many siblings, parents of adult children with BPD, where they're not, it's not like the 87%, it's really difficult. I'm not saying they should go no contact or let go. Some will, and many will say, I will never do that, no matter what. And of course, they suffer all kinds of health consequences, etc. But I'm not a parent, so I don't know how a parent feels. I'm not touching that with a 10-foot pole. So this disconnect is really at the core, with a whole lot of other stuff, of what's really going on and how people on opposite sides of a fence, maybe that's a lousy way to put it, opposite sides of two roads where the bridge doesn't intersect and connect you, people on the one side really hurting and wanting the other person to be able to, you know, and people with BPD or NPD on the other side, you're not getting it. And people with BPD and people with NPD, to different degrees, manifest differently. They're not the same thing. They are in a trauma response of not being able to form a healthy ego, of not being able to know self, of having arrested emotional development. People with BPD by or before the age of two, people with NPD or who get diagnosed with NPD, more or less between about the age of three and on, 3 to 5 in there somewhere. And where do I come up with these numbers and this information? No, I don't just make it up or think I know it all. It comes from the leading clinicians and pioneers in a field that had much more awareness, insight, and humanity at times to it than it does now. Leading mental health clinicians, many who have passed now, but like Dr. John Gunderson on BPD, Heinz Kohut on narcissistic personality disorder, very different take because I believe he himself had narcissistic personality disorder. There's many ways to look at these things, but when you are somebody being inundated and hurt and losing yourself, or you don't know yourself that well, as many people with codependency and having these relationships and coming from these family systems don't know yourself as well as you think you do. And then for the people that get into the relationship with the cluster B, and maybe you've had other relationships before and they weren't somebody with BPD or NPD, and you didn't know what you were getting into, and then why does it become such a sinkhole of, you know, the trauma bond and you can't get out? And that's not all about the person with BPD or NPD. It's also about your woundedness, if you are the loved one or the ex or whatever the case, and if you understand where that codependency might be in your experience and how you've learned to relate from childhood. So, great big divide, a great big disconnect, and all people with BPD aren't the same, all people with NPD aren't the same, people with BPD, NPD aren't the same, all codependents aren't the same, all loved ones of those with BPD or NPD aren't the same. But I really found that question at the end fascinating. What do people need, or what do you need from siblings? Maybe reframe the question to what do you want, and then ascertain for yourself whether you work with someone or not, but journal it. Because if what you want, let alone what you might need, isn't there, then what are you going to do for you? As opposed to, and same thing in significant other relationships, if what you expect, what you need, what you want from a partner isn't what you're experiencing, why are you still there? And yes, the emotions run high and it's very difficult, but I'm going to have something coming soon at ajmahari.ca. Yes, I'm going to be doing a few mini course type things, and it's going to answer that question. But of course, any question that I can really answer, and I'm going to be doing a more in-depth dive there about all of the reasons and the realities of what happens to people trying to love somebody with BPD, with BPD primarily, I'll stick with for now, when they're not treated and what's happening to you and why you can't stop wanting to go forward when it's the last thing in the world that is healthy or reasonable for you to do, but you feel compelled, you feel obsessed. Why is that? And I'm going to have so much more coming about that. And I just want to stress again, I have compassion for people with BPD, and I have compassion for people on the other side, and I have compassion for people with NPD. Doesn't mean I want to relate to one personally. I'll work with people with these issues, but I don't want to have a narcissist or a borderline in my personal life, or even in my sphere, actually. Like, I mean, other than my work, which I totally respect my clients, no matter what their issues and challenges, but like, what I shared in a video a little while ago about borderline manipulation, or the provocation of borderline manipulation, whatever the title was, and the experience I had recently. You know, these people, unfortunately, broken and wounded, but just waiting, not on purpose, but to wound you too, unfortunately, not on purpose all the time at all. There, in every walk of life, there are so many more of them. It is exponentially increasing. And you know what? Not a one of us are helping the situation if it's the us versus them. Now, you may have to get out of the relationship. You might have to work out that and go your own way, whether it's family or not. Any relationship type. You may have to quit a job because the boss is a narcissist and you just can't. You know what I mean? But the thing is, it doesn't mean that we then are, or the people that aren't personality disordered, we are better than the personality disordered. It's not this, well, I and they're so, and we need to have a humanistic view of this, not a pathologizing view. And I really believe in that, even though I remain a lightning rod for so many people with BPD on the internet, where my name comes up so often in really, well, you know, non-flattering, I'll just leave it at that, ways, and that's fine. But it's while they're trying to say that I'm hurting all of them so badly somehow, when I go to the lengths to try to show that I see both sides and I care about both sides, unlike a lot of other people out there, I'm not saying I'm the only one, and I become this lightning rod for, I saw something once on Reddit and somebody was talking about when they got online, and it was a bunch of people with BPD talking to each other. I just saw it. I wasn't looking for it. And they, because I don't really like that site, and I don't go there often, so sometimes in a search, it'll pop up. And somebody said about people that were helpful talking about BPD, and of course, I'm talking about BPD largely to help others, but I do work, there are people who listen to these videos, ladies and gentlemen, of BPD, that unlike the people that have to, like, unfortunately, from where they're at, throw stuff at me, and blame me for all this stuff, apparently, they think I'm doing to them. There are other people that understand what I'm saying, and they're in a lot of pain and they want to change, and they come to work with me. So that's how vastly different people with BPD are. And my other point was, so in this one thread, wherever, I shouldn't mention where, I don't know where it is, and so they're talking about people with BPD are talking about people that have helped them or they understood or whatever information, and one person, and I saw my name come up and I'm like, oh, here we go. And yeah, they said that I can't remember the exact words, I guess something like, I hate all people with BPD, which is not true. And then that I was really violent about how I talk about people with BPD. Now, maybe somebody with BPD who feels that way is going to come along and say, yeah, you are. But, like, that's not even in the realm of reality. So, but, you know, I don't take those things personally. And when people are in a lot of pain, and they really don't know who they are, and they're broken, and they have a fragmented child part of self. So that's like in the transactional model of parent, adult, child, three parts of ego. They have a fragmented ego. And unless and until they do the work to heal that, which is great prognosis for people with BPD that will go get treatment. It's getting better for some people with NPD as well, using some of the same modalities of treatment, like transference focused psychotherapy, as help people with BPD. So, but when I say that, I don't want anybody going through a living nightmare right now to think that means that the person that you're with, or the person you love, or your sister, your mother, your whoever, your ex, your partner, your on-off person with BPD is going to be one of those people that's going to go and do the healing and recovery work. And the last thing I'll say here too, I'm going to have something coming on soon, is this idea of BPD and what is a sociopath and what is a sadistic nature that a lot of people with BPD will show sometimes. Doesn't mean they're wholly sadistic. It does not mean they're sociopathic, whatever that means, because that's a slippery slope term and sort of definition that isn't in the DSM and flies kind of like sort of as a, you know, replacement term to psychopathy, which it isn't. And but so much of BPD has nothing to do with psychopathy or sociopathy. And if there's a sadistic nature in there, I can fully well explain that. And the explanation isn't the same for all people with BPD. So, and I went through something like that in my childhood. And I know that it was directly related to what was happening to me. And I worked that out in therapy as well. And I didn't go around being sadistic 24/7 at all. So again, I bring to what I talk about here, work with clients. And if you resonate with me, you like to work with me, just please check out ajmahari.ca/sessions. I bring both sides of this and lived experience plus education plus 33 years worth of helping people, whether they have BPD, NPD, have codependency, in relationship breakups and or wanting the ex back, narcissist or borderline, or I mean, I've worked with lots of people even who've been in relationships or you know, parent relationship, like adult child of psychopaths, etc. And I've even worked with the odd psychopath. Now, let me just say in conclusion here, finally, it's long, but if you hang in, you never know, you might get some gems here and there if I resonate with you. When I've worked with a few people who were psychopaths, it had various nature to the work. It wasn't like, hey, this is a process and I'm going to be able to help this person who's diagnosed with antisocial personality disorder. No, but there were other reasons, and I can't get into the details just because to this day, some of them were a little bit harrowing experiences in many different ways, but I wasn't trying to think that I could really help or change or help change. I can't change anybody. Work to help a psychopath change. It wasn't like that. And there are many reasons why people come with different, you know, issues like psychopathy even, or people with BPD, obviously, and NPD, etc., why they would come to work with someone like myself, because, well, I just try to do the best I can with everybody, and I take a humanistic view of this, and I've listened to people with fragile, covert, you know, fragile, vulnerable, covert narcissism who can be very, very like the sheep in wolf's clothing, blah, 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 as they're described out there, and experienced. But I've worked with many of them when they finally do get past all the walls of the defenses, close to decompensating, and they realize what's going on for them. And the screams and the agony and the crying and the grief, and it's real when they get to that point in a coaching or therapeutic process. So where I'm coming from all the time when I'm giving information about this or that side of whatever is that I believe in the humanity of some psychopaths not, but they're not all violent, right? But I believe in the humanity of people no matter what the circumstances, situations, and whatever label they might, you know, kind of have their issues under. And I really, really don't believe in the American Psychiatric Association with the hegemony of big pharma, etc. And I hope to get something done, and it will be unfortunately available for sale at ajmahari.ca and not here on the channel for free. And it's not because I want your money or I want more money. It's simply because if you have an interest enough and you have an open mind enough that you want to understand why the biology of BPD is crap and they don't know what they're talking about and more, then I'm going to have something coming over there. I don't want to say soon, hopefully within a few months. And I'll put it on the channel when it's available. Because I've said a lot about that here, and people continue to. And a lot of clients really tell me and thank me for the fact that I don't just go down, you know, the echo chamber middle line of talk about black and white dichotomous thinking. These YouTubers, oh, 15 ways to beat the narcissist, blah, 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 blah. And can I throw in here just for your added extra bonus if you made it to the end? Dr. Romney, who I really respect and think knows a tremendous amount about cluster B personality disorders, etc. You know, interchanging the word narcissism with narcissistic personality disorder, fundamental error. What is up with the echo chamber? Because the echo chamber is based on the baloney of the DSM and the pathologizing of humanity. And there are things we need to have defined and detailed in certain ways. We need to learn how to navigate the world from a healthy self and a self with agency and autonomy. But that doesn't mean we're not going to get hurt. We need to learn how to cope emotionally. And I think my point earlier was, you know, generationally speaking, this intergenerational trauma has probably been going on all throughout history in different ways, but really much more known since the silent generation and how they raised the baby boom generation, and then what happened with the baby boom generation and the next generation and the next generation. By the way, it's not all baby boomers' faults, but some of them did. You know, I'm a late stage one, so some of the ones that were 10, 20 years older than me, I didn't like them either. I thought they were way too entitled. So anyway, that's a whole other thing. Bottom line is, this is a major disconnect. Do people with BPD have empathy or not? People with BPD saying they have all this uber extra empathy, and what this commenter said. And frankly, I don't really think that's the case. Because even if that were the case, that somebody had so much empathy with BPD, or even without BPD, that would be an issue called unhealthy empathy, or what some people like to call, quote, malignant empathy. I don't know why we have to put, why does the echo chamber on YouTube and elsewhere online have to put everything into these neat little boxes? Well, the answer, first answer, is because they need their clicks and their views. They want to be popular and famous. I don't care about any of that crap. I'm just here to help people. And, you know, I'm not a selfless person, but when I'm helping people in sessions, it's not about me. But the one thing I bring to the table is that this is a mission of mine, and it's a naturally created mission. Really, I believe it's like this is a God's Army t-shirt, because I am a member of God's Army, and I do believe in God. But I'm not a fundamentalist Christian, and I do not proselytize to people or try to get anyone to think differently than they do. But I just wanted to add here quickly that in my experience of working with people, and this is my mission in the way that I serve God, based on the healing that I believe, you know, the therapist helped me, I helped me, but God helped me too. And my point is, I don't think whether you believe in God or not, or you have like other spiritual ways of believing, viewing things, whatever the case, that whatever the purpose we're here for, it's not to keep dividing and conquering ourselves. We have an elitist globalist reality trying to do that to us, that's been doing that to us for centuries, of divide and conquer with all kinds of different issues. And I mean politics, the right, the left, now we have the woke, that's a big problem, and other things. And you know, like, and so politically, I'm not involved. I'm not on the left, not on the right. I try to look at everything from the center, and sometimes it's a lonely place to sit, but I find that lonely place to sit in contemplation often nothing but an amazing pathway to learning more and more all the time. I learn from clients. I learn from, you know, even giving these comment responses, but I learned from a lot of people's comments as well. And so I'm always trying to help, never trying to disrespect a commenter. Well, maybe there was a couple times with people at BP that were acting out. I wasn't being disrespectful, but I was walking on the edge. Anyway, this has really been too long. I apologize for that. But you know what? I do believe in the echo chamber of YouTube, in the narcissistic, now I'm not calling everybody a narcissist, it's different. In the narcissistic world in which we live today with sound bites, I do believe in long form content. So if you really want to get the value, I believe, that I give, and you'll decide whether you agree with that or not. Yeah, long-term form content. I'm going to try to do some short things, but I don't know that short things really say much of anything, except for the echo chamber YouTubers who are wanting to definitely hit on certain points for you. So you want to come back and click, and they get popular and famous and rich and all that stuff. I'm not popular. I'm not famous. I don't have a big growing channel, and I'm never going to be rich. And frankly, I think that's pretty cool because we don't all value the same things. So please be kind to yourself today, whether you have BPD, you have NPD, or you're worried or scared you think you might have one or the other, or you have codependency and maybe you know that and it's very painful and you don't know what to do, or you're still thinking and denying that, no, I can't possibly be codependent because whatever. The labels aren't so important, except that they can guide people like myself who really just want to help clients to find peace, mental health, and balance in their lives and go forward in independent, autonomous ways to find meaning and purpose and happiness too. But happiness isn't a goal in life. You know, that's something that's a byproduct. And so people that are focused too much on happiness are going to find the journey a whole lot more difficult than when you're looking for peace and for knowing yourself and healing and recovery that just brings so much and can bring happiness too. So we have this big divide, this big disconnect over BPD and empathy and can they... And you know what? It's so individual. So what's been your experience? If you got to the end of this, congratulations, because most people won't. Take care.